The story of Heart of Midlothian Football Club is a remarkable tale of a club steeped in its nation's history, a club which has tasted agonising disappointment, but also glorious triumph. Today's multi-million pound stadium may seem far removed from the humble beginnings of the club, but the traditions and passion for the Hearts, as strong today as it was in 1873 when a group of young men who attended a dancing club in Washing Green Court, now lost under Dumby Dyke's flats, were lured by the excitement of the emerging sport of football. The name of the dance club was Heart of Midlothian. The seeds of Hearts history were sown here, in the East Meadows. In December 1873, the dance hall footballers were inspired by an exhibition match between Queen's Park and Clydesdale. The captaincy of the club was, and still is, a great honour. The first bearer of that responsibility was decided by a one-on-one competition between Tom Purdy and the future club secretary, Jake Three Fingers Reid. Tom Purdy was victorious by 3-2, establishing his position in the club, which would endure for many successful years. In those days before private stadiums, the club's headquarters was Mother Anderson's Tavern on the southwest corner of West Cross Causeway, where the team would change into their strips before being led by Purdy across the road to the Meadows. In August 1875, they joined the Scottish Football Association and played in the Scottish Cup for the first time. This is the oldest photograph of a Hearts team in that year, proudly displaying their new strip of all white with a maroon heart emblazoned on the chest. By season 1877-78, Hibs were already rivals of Hearts, and in the fourth replay of the Edinburgh Association Cup, the Maroons defeated the Irishmen by 4-3 to give them their first ever trophy. By now, the Meadows were overcrowded with teams and spectators, so Hearts decided to play major fixtures at West Powbon, where Savile Terrace now stands. A great advantage was that they could now collect admission fees, which were kept in an old school bag. The club finally settled in Gorgie in 1881, not at the present site, but across Gorgie Road, where Wardlaw Street and Wardlaw Place now stand. Finally, in April 1886, they moved the short distance to the site of today's magnificent Tynecastle Stadium. In 1890, the Scottish League was formed. Hearts were one of the founder members, and the following year they won the Scottish Cup for the first time, beating Dumbarton 1-0 at Hampden. On their return to Edinburgh, the horses were uncoupled from the player's carriage and it was pulled through the streets by ecstatic fans. This was a golden age for Hearts. In 1893, they beat Hibs 10-2 at Easter Road. In 1894-95, they became league champions for the first time, winning 11 games in a row. The Scottish Cup final of 1896, played for the only time outside Glasgow at Logie Green in Edinburgh, was fittingly against Hibernian. These remarkable photographs give an insight into the game, which Hearts won by 3-1. In 1897, Hearts beat Hibs into second place in the league to lift the championship trophy for the second time. At the turn of the century, the club's star player was Bobby Walker, who with 29 caps still holds the international honours record for Hearts. He went on to help them win the cup again in 1901, beating Celtic 4-3. They won the cup again in 1906 and were firmly established as the dominant side in the east of Scotland. In 1914, after defeating champion Celtic 2-0 and winning 8 victories in a row, Hearts looked set to win the title. But with the spectre of war sweeping across Europe, the entire Hearts first team, along with 400 shareholders and season ticket holders, joined the army. 11 players were badly wounded in action, and 7 made the ultimate sacrifice, giving their lives for their country. A memorial was built at Haymarket to commemorate the men who died, and 40,000 people gathered to pay their respects. Even today, on Armistice Sunday, Hearts players and officials lay a wreath at its base. This is the oldest known footage of Heart of Midlothian. It was shot on the 16th of August 1924, when Hearts met Cowdenbeath at Central Park. Cowdenbeath were playing their first match in the First Division. Hearts won 2-1, and the team included Jock White, who would score 4 goals in a game for 3 consecutive games. That's a British record which stands to this day. The 1930s produced a wealth of talent at Tynecastle, not least Barney Battles, who scored 31 goals in his first season and then 44 league goals in 1930-31. Just for good measure, he netted 11 goals against Hibs in 4 weeks in 1929. But the most famous talent was Tommy Walker, a great player who would go on to manage the club and stay at Tynecastle for over 35 years. Another of Hearts' great internationalists, he became a national hero in 1938 when Tommy Walker scored the only goal at Wembley to defeat England.
Only one goal was scored early in the first half by Tommy Walker, famous Scottish footballer.
Sadly, in 1939, the world was once again plunged into warfare and professional football was suspended. But the 1950s were a renaissance for Hearts. Once again, silverware was brought to Tynecastle.
I would say the Hearts team in the 50s is probably the best, certainly in my lifetime, and particularly when you bear in mind the calibre of the opposition, when you consider that Hibernian were a very good side then, Rangers were consistently a good side, Celtic every 4 or 5 years or so came up with a good side, Aberdeen were useful. There was certainly very much more competition than there is today. I mean, people thought they could go to Ibrox and beat Rangers. I've often thought too that it was very important that they had as a manager somebody who was quintessentially a Hearts man, Tommy Walker, who had been absolutely idolised as a player and then came back. And for somebody who was quite self-effacing and quiet, was a very, very good manager indeed.
But good managers need good players, and one of the most prominent at the time was John Cumming, who won more medals than any other Hearts player. Like many of that time, he was the product of a tough mining community.
I was brought up the right way in a miner's row. Then with me being in the pits and that, and my father had said to me, you know, if you want to be a footballer, out. You know, and that was part and parcel. But it was a good thing to be in the pits because of the, you know, the strength which you had.
Not every miner was a great club man, but they did produce players who were. And John Cumming, certainly that. It'd be quite interesting if you took a poll of Hearts players of all time. I think he would come out very, very high on the list, might even win it. Because it was about 14 years as a player, came from Carluke Rovers in Lanarkshire. Very, very hard player, very fair player, very undemonstrative player. Rarely, if ever, do I remember seeing John Cumming either retaliate or reacting against referees' decisions. He must have done from time to time, but it wasn't a standard of his game.
That's right, it's control. Oh, you don't, once you lose that, you know, I mean, nobody worried me because I was brought up, as I told you, in the mine, and I was brought up, that, well, the crime of the Iron Man, it's nothing to do with the Iron Man, it's because of the way I was brought up in a miner's row, you know, and my father was a miner, and I know these things are part and parcel of aggression. Aggression is a thing. I'm not talking about hitting people with your elbows and things like that. Use your body, and the game gets flowing. In our day, it never stopped the game.
John will be one of these players that never made an awful lot of money out of the game. He played more for the jersey, there's no doubt about that. And he was just a terrific man. And even in my day as a player here, he was always when the manager says, right, let's get two sides picked. John was, he would maybe pull out two lads and say, right, you pick one, you pick the other. And everybody's first pick was John Cummins. And he was worth 3 men in the team. And even the players, given that number of years away, they still hated playing against him. And he was a fantastic character. And, you know, I like to, you know, to be a competitor and give 100%. I think John liked that in a player. And because that was the way he was himself, and you know, a terrific man.
With players of John Cummings' quality, it seemed only a matter of time until Hearts would win a trophy. John played in the crucial League Cup final of 1954, and his uncompromising style of play influenced a 20-year-old who would form part of a formidable defence.
I went to watch Hearts 5-6 years old and never missed a game, obviously till I started playing myself. But never missed a game watching Hearts. Used to go and get in for nothing. I was so small, I got under the gate, the big heavy iron gates. Played on the terracing for at least, no exaggeration, 3 hours before the game kicked off, or before the terracing filled up. So I was always a Hearts fanatic, and still am.
Hearts won the final 4-2, with one player who would be immortalised as part of the famous terrible trio scoring a hat-trick, Willie Bald. The partnership of Bald, Alfie Conn and Jimmy Wardhaw contributed 703 goals in the Cup and League competitions and assured their place in the record books for all time.
Perfect understanding between the three of them. Alfie, he was the strong one with the hardest shot, and they were all different in their own right. As I say, Alfie was so strong and his shooting ability was fantastic. From distance, Jimmy Wardhaw, tricky little guy, or not a little guy, but reasonable guy, Willie Bald ahead, and Jimmy Ward always poking in goals.
That simple philosophy brought their next success, the Scottish Cup final of 1956 against Celtic. Hearts had already beaten Rangers 4-0 in the quarter-final and were confident of adding another piece of silverware to the Tynecastle cabinet.
Great now. To Fernie, the man who can hold the ball. Now it's Conn. Tackle, beaten. And it's making it clear as it comes out of Wardhaw now. And once more is Fernie loses to Wardhaw. Now it's Peacock trailing it away. And it comes now to Mackay, let's go! And it was a fierce one from a halfback.
Right. Dave was a lad that he liked to go and attack. You know, he was an attacker. And I used to say, you know, when you go, and when he went, I just bounced it. You know, because of the bounce of the field. Dave liked to go, and he was a player, he was a hard player. And he liked to go forward, and it was an extra man with your five forwards.
With all those options, the crowd of nearly 133,000 didn't have to wait long before Hearts scored.
To Tully, forward door to Fernie. Left touchline. Beaten by Cumming, now it's Wardhaw, who hits him from long range. Wardhaw to Crawford. And it's a goal! Come to Bald! Hearts in the dark jerseys leading in the Scottish Cup final by 1-0 and kicking off for the second half. Cumming, who was injured, Hearts' left half, has returned, so both teams have 11 players.
Not many harder than John Cummings, believe me. He's still hard to this day. And against Celtic, I think he split his eye open and just went off, got it stitched up, come back. Who's the first one to get up and head the ball? John Cummings. Whereas other people think, I can't head it, I've split my eye open. He didn't care, he was up there heading balls. He's a brilliant player, he was.
Bald and Evan. Bald, number nine. Bald for Hearts. Bald, number nine, centre forward out on the left touchline. Bald, relieving the pressure, right up towards Celtic's goal mouth. Bald, still on the ball. Young to Crawford, and it's a goal! Taken by Kirk. Now it's Bald, heading it forward. It comes to Conn, and it's a goal! Ten minutes to go, and Hearts team dance with joy. A fierce effort, a tremendous shot by Conn. Puts Hearts in the lead by 3-1, and 10 minutes to go. History, football history in the making.
I think the 56 Cup final win was really fairy tale stuff. There had been a folk legend in Edinburgh that Hearts would never win the Cup as long as the trams ran in the Gorgay Road. And in 1956, guess what? The tram lines were lifted in the Gorgay Road.
1957-58 was a truly remarkable season for Hearts. In their first four games, they scored 25 goals. The tally would rise to 132 by May. They beat Hibs each time they met and defeated both Rangers and Celtic home and away. By the end of the season, they had won the championship, 13 points ahead of second-placed Rangers.
Yeah, well, we were getting a pound a goal. That's how we started winning, by heavy scores. But that's true, we got a pound a goal. For every goal, we scored more than the opposition. But it was easy for us, because we had such a good team. We had such a good forward line. I mind just Cornbold and Wartell. You had your wingers as well. We had an excellent team, so it wasn't a fluke that we won trophies. You've got to have a good team to win things.
This was a glorious time to be a Hearts supporter. The League Cup rarely left Tynecastle, Hearts winning it again in 1958, 59 and 62. For the second time in 3 years in 1960, beating Kilmarnock into second place by 4 points after a thrilling 4-4 draw at St Mirren clinched the title. But inevitably, the greatest team in Hearts history eventually broke up and the club's fortunes waned. In 1964-65, Hearts were denied the championship by 0.04 of a goal using the old goal average system. One consolation was a 5-3 victory over old rivals Hibs.
Found the chink in the Hibs defence and a good one in. A beautiful header there by Alan Gordon. A wonderful heavy goal after 28 minutes to put Hearts one goal up in this derby, perhaps rather against the run of play, but a beautifully taken goal after smart work there by Wallace and Trainer. Moving dangerously on Hibs' goal again. And just fails to get his cross over, but now Gordon's taken the block. Very neat play, and it's into Wallace inside the penalty area. And it's the second goal! Billy Wallace there, from inside the penalty area, right-footed, shots Hearts into a 2-0 lead after 31 minutes. And that makes it 8 goals this season for Willie Wallace. Another left-footed one from Johnny Hamilton, swinging in, pushed out, and goal there, pushed out by Billy Wilson to Alan Gordon, and the young inside left, right-footed, shot the ball cleanly into the net. Not a very good clearance there, I'm afraid, by Billy Wilson, but the chance snapped up very well and very smartly by Alan Gordon after 19 minutes of the second half. Away by Poland. Forward now to Gordon. Out on the right wing, into the penalty area, right footed across, punched away, there by Wilson and Tommy White. A cracking shot right through, right into the middle of the goal. And now Hearts go 4-2 ahead in this rollicking derby game here in the rain at Easter Road. Shevlin, well up again, helping on his attack. A high one, it's a good one. Play. Tommy Trainer has scored the fifth goal for Hearts, and it's now Hearts 5, Hibs 2.
2 years later, Hearts star striker Willie Wallace was sold to Celtic. And although they did beat Rangers to reach the Scottish Cup final in 1968, where they lost to Dunfermline, there were few highlights for the club in the late 60s. The 70s brought varied fortunes for Hearts. They did reach another Cup final, but major victories were rare against the old firm. When they did, though, they came occasionally in unconventional ways.
Round to Mentmuir, nice dummy. Ford coming in, wins possession for Hearts, gives it to Carruthers. Brown behind him. Park away on the far side, Carruthers holding on to it, waiting for Brown to get into position. 4 minutes to play. Back to Murray. Seat on the ball. Away come Hearts as Brown, low and hard across goal. Headed down and it's there! A sensation! Ford the scorer from that superb cross by Brown.
A goal to remember. In 1976, the two teams met again in the Scottish Cup final, but the treble-winning Ibrox side were to prove too strong.
A plane with Greg. In goes Johnson, it's here! To run straight towards the penalty area. Heading for the shot. This must be a goal. Graham Shaw, bold effort by Hearts at this stage. 3-1.
It wasn't a happy memory for Tynecastle fans, but that game did see three future Hearts managers involved: Tommy McLean, Alex McDonald, and Jim Jeffries.
Yeah, it was a bad time. My spell after the final, I think things seemed to go downhill there. I think the club ran into a bit of financial problems, and you know, we've eventually seen changes taking place at the club, with directors moving on and other people coming in to try and resurrect it. And you know, the managers that had not long after the cup final had very little to work with in terms of bringing players to the club, and we had to scour around the lower divisions.
Jeffrey's got up well. Busby battling on. Gibson going! And scoring! Shaw to Park. Thinking about a shot. And it's a goal! And Shaw controlling it. Looking up, sees the man in the clear. Jim Brown's on the right, unmarked, and a big gap here. Gibson coming to the near post, Busby at the far post. So's Prentice. Gibson, a hat-trick!
Despite some good individual performances, season 1976-77 was a disastrous one for Hearts. For the first time in their history, they were relegated to the First Division. But under the captaincy of Jim Jeffries, Hearts' time in the lower division lasted just one season. Once again, they had joined the top flight of Scottish football. In the first Edinburgh derby of that season, Hearts were determined to make an impact.
It's Donald, doesn't control it. Donald Park will score. Donald Park puts Hearts one up. Hearts moving, Robertson drifting left, looking for a good ball and getting it. Brown coming in, up in support, Robertson drifting in, tries a right foot shot and it's there. Now Craig can knock that into the box with those long throws, finds Busby. Busby hooks it across, down to Fraser. Fraser's got a free shot. They're deflected, appeals for hands and driven in by, yes, it's a goal. Fraser to take it. Headed in and it's there. In the net.
But the club was still in deep financial trouble, and as a result, the fans' favourite, Eamon Bannon, was sold to Chelsea for a record fee of £215,000. The supporters were to suffer further anguish when Hearts were once again relegated. As the season wore on, changes had to be made. Willie Ormond was replaced as manager by Bobby Moncur. Under Moncur in 1980-81, Hearts rejoined the Premier Division. New signings had been made, with one of the most significant being Alex McDonald from Rangers.
Denny playing it over the advancing wall and Chincon onside. A chance for Hearts. McDonald scores for Hearts. What a start to the match for Alex McDonald. Look at the joy on his face.
But joy turned to despair as Hearts were relegated again. It was a dark time in the club's great history, and in 1981, Heart of Midlothian was put up for sale. Wallace Mercer was the man who bought the club, and he was faced with massive problems.
When he came on the scene, the share capital was £5,000, which was not all taken up. And he immediately, I think, began to say, you cannot run a business on this basis. You cannot run a business like the neighbourhood bowling club or something like that. And he changed it.
As a result, Alex McDonald was appointed manager in 1982, and it was to be the start of a famous renaissance for the club.
Side, and that's the equaliser. To Robertson. Well, there's a curl in Anderson.
There's deflection, I think. One each.
Donald and assistant manager Sandy Jardine brought Hearts back to the Premier League in 83-84. Memories of First Division football now consigned to distant memory.
Very, very professional. He started to have talks with the young boys about what he expected from them on and off the pitch, about their behaviour, etc. And when we could have won, he was the first player to teach us how to eat and talk and shake hands properly, so to speak. And that's the kind of man he was. He was very, very professional, and it was all about fitness, looking after yourself. He didn't mind you going for a beer or two then again, but he wanted you to work really hard at your training. And really mixed together as a team. He really brought the team together. He brought the club together, and started the sort of close-knit community that Hearts is today.
O'Callaghan McDonald's man management was second to none. He had just had a way with players, getting the best out of players, and he had a great ally in Sandy Jardine. They bounced off each other. And when you look back, their careers as players was such that everybody respected them. They attracted Willie Johnston, who represented Scotland in the World Cups, Jimmy Bone, who was a great professional, Sandy Clark and the likes. And to attract these players to the Hearts 4 or 5 years after we were in the First Division was a great boost to everybody within the club.
That confidence was amply demonstrated in 1984. Hearts' spectacular team spirit shone through. Rangers, at 2-0 up, seemed to be cruising towards victory. But the Tynecastle side had other plans.
Here's Johnson. 2 minutes left. Will they let fly? He does, and that's a goal, yes. Derek O'Connor following up. And we've gone a full minute of injury time. Congested area, indeed, and this, it's in. It's equaliser. Brilliant play by Robertson.
20-year-old Robertson was one of the new breed of young players, among them Craig Levein and future captain Gary Mackay, who would lead Hearts for the next 13 years.
Can't get there. Here's Mackay, will he get his shot? And he does, yes!
We were always told stories as a young lad that one or two of the older players would actually be a wee bit jealous that a young lad coming through and taking their positions, but I never actually found that was true, because the professionals there realised that they were getting to the end of their career, and they wanted to give us as much help and as encouragement as they could. As I say, two or three already, I've mentioned Willie Johnston, Jimmy Bone, they were magnificent for the Hearts, both on and particularly off the park, the way they nurtured the young talent along.
Yeah, I mean, Gary, he's probably fed up people saying that he's Mr. Hearts, but he is. I mean, he would bleed maroon, and ever since I've known him, we played in the first Salveson teams at under-12s. He was a captain, led by example. And if you're looking for a role model for younger kids, you could do worse than get Gary Mackay, because he's a terrific ambassador for everything he does, you know, at Hearts and now even at Airdrie, on and off the park. Gary Mackay was always a player that I could link with up all the time. I mean, it got to the stage where, you know, it was like telepathic. I knew everything he was going to do. He knew everything I was going to do. I wasn't even in the space, and he was rolling balls into where I was going. It was a terrific relationship. The football side of things was fantastic, because it was 1-2s. The amount of goals he set up for me was incredible. I set up a few for him in his time as well. But he epitomised Hearts at the time. He was all action, very positive player. And you need to have positive players in your team.
Another player with a very positive attitude was Sandy Clark, who from his first game in 1984 brought another dimension to the Hearts attack.
Very accurate header that from Winnie. Rooney let it run, allowing Kit to make the challenge. And Sandy Clark is onside, a great chance for Hearts. And there's the opener, brilliantly finished by Sandy Clark. There goes Sandy Clark once again. Delicate touch. And there's the second for Hearts.
Hearts finished seventh in the league in season 1984-85, but the confidence which had been instilled in the squad was significant. The following season would turn out to be one of the most dramatic in the club's history. However, after taking only 6 points from their first 9 games, the omens did not look good.
Greg Levine, the captain, Roddy McDonald, number 5, as the corner comes in. McDonald's header. And the simplest of opening goals for Hearts. Out by Hegarty, there's Cowie lofting it back. Ball on side. John Robertson. 2-0 to Hearts.
After beating Celtic 1-0 at Parkhead and then Rangers 3-0 in November, Hearts were close to the top of the table, and realisation was gradually dawning that the title was not an impossible dream. In March, they played a crucial match against Rangers.
The opening goal! 8 minutes of the match, and John Robertson makes 1-0 to Hearts. So here's a moment of danger for the Rangers defence once again, with Kenny Black taking the free kick. Up goes Sandy Clark. It hits the post, but with a bit of pushing, there's a penalty kick awarded, is there? No, what has the referee awarded? It looks like a penalty kick, yes. So it's Robertson against Walker. 2-0 to Hearts. The clearance, no, missed by Munro. Back to Robertson, the chance for Sandy Clark. Yes! Sandy Clark makes it 3-1 to Hearts right on the final whistle.
The race for the league title was well and truly on. Only 4 games stood between Hearts and the Championship.
High one again. Robertson with a shot, and what a goal! Oh, a brilliant goal! Hearts are one up. Ball to Berry, he's in a good position. Billy Thompson, he has a great chance, he scored. 2-0. Sandy Clark. It could be a very interesting break. There's no offside, this could show it. Robertson must score. He must, yes.
Pumping the ball forward, there's no taker for Aberdeen, and Jordan has lots of time to set up another Hearts attack. Appeals for offside, with a chance.
Touch of confidence, that kind of confidence they could do with in front of goal now. Mackay. Will he go himself? He has!
In the final match of the season against Dundee at Dens, Hearts needed only a draw to claim the trophy.
Bringing in, very dangerous.
It was horrendous. It's everything you can imagine and more. I know the fans felt it badly, but the players took it even worse because we were on the park and could have done something about it. It's indescribable. Everybody was literally physically sick in the dressing room afterwards. There's nothing you could do. And I think genuinely that if we'd won the league, we'd have won the cup. We'd have won the double that year.
Even though we lost the 2 games at the tail end of the season, the League One and the Cup Final, it is a time that I would never have ever swapped for anything, because it was a great experience to go 30-31 games undefeated and to get Hearts back in the public eye, because they had fell away, as I said, during the 70s. It lifted everybody and it also allowed, within a year or two, the likes of myself, John Robertson, Craig Levine, to then go on and gain international honours as well, along John Cahoon, Henry Smith, and that meant Hearts had regained a lot of pride, the supporters had regained a lot of pride that there were players then starting to represent their country again as well.
After such a shattering disappointment, many people felt that Hearts' morale would collapse completely. However, in the first derby match of the following season, they were determined to show that their spirit was far from broken. Season 87-88 saw Hearts once again among the elite, finishing second in the championship.
This is Galloway. Tremendous goal from Mike Galloway. Well, nice running ball, but there's no offside. Here's Wayne Foster. That's in. Robertson, 1-0. Oh, there's a great chance now. It's the second one. Galloway. Oh, what a mess Rogan made of that.
In the Scottish Cup campaign, Hearts reached another semi-final, having scored 8 goals in the previous 3 rounds.
Hooks it in and White was there. And again, Whittaker, up goes, it's in from Whittaker.
With only 3 minutes left, Hearts looked set for another Scottish Cup final.
That's a near post one. Henry Smith is up. They can't get it in. It's gone in. Mark McGee. That's a tantalising one. Goals given. Walker is getting the congratulations.
In the league, Hearts had finished runners-up to Celtic, which had earned them a place in the UEFA Cup and a return of the unique atmosphere of those big European nights. It also saw the return of Eamon Bannon, after a 9-year absence.
Galloway. Again, good running by Ferguson. There's Eamon Bannon with a chance there. Well, how often he has done that with the Neil Iden in European games. Sneaking into the back. A lovely piece of play by Mackay. And Ferguson, who, by the way, I think has had an excellent evening so far. And look at this. Off the side of the foot and the post. Whittaker. Offside to Galloway. Tries to knock it down. Ferguson. That must be a chance. It is. Galloway. Trying to sneak in, there's Galloway. Oh, he lost touch. That's not a bad ball. Here's Cahoon with a chance. He scored! Right at the death, Hearts scored 3-0.
Hearts' next opponents were the mighty Bayern Munich, who had scored 12 goals in their previous away ties. Few outside Tynecastle gave Hearts a chance.
Very convincing at all from the keeper. But can they break through now? Here's Tosh McKinley with the free kick. Sideways to Ferguson. Brilliantly finished by Ferguson! Hearts take the lead! And you, Ferguson savours the moment. So too do the Tynecastle faithful. Well, this was a shot of stunning power from Ian Ferguson.
Striker John Robertson had also returned to Tynecastle after an 8-month spell at Newcastle. His reappearance was to prove costly to his favourite opponents.
Bannon leaves it, there's Ferguson. O'Bannon!
The new decade brought a new manager in the shape of Joe Jordan, who took over from Alex McDonald in September 1990. It was a turbulent time in Edinburgh, as Wallace Mercer had made an abortive bid for the takeover of Hibs. All of this made for an explosive fixture against Hibs, with Hearts under the temporary charge of Sandy Clark.
It was probably the most highly charged atmosphere I've ever seen at a football match. The Hibs fans were still feeling injustice about the fact that Wallace had allegedly attempted to wipe them out. And the Hearts fans had gone down there to try and win a game, and they were giving the Hibs fans stick, and police expected there to be a lot of trouble, and we were told the Hibs players were going to, you know, come out all guns blazing to show that they were worthy of being a Birmingham Football Club's identity, and that they were going to show that they were as good as Hearts.
Ian Foster, on the edge of the penalty area, as Levine plays it through. Hillard getting the touch to it. Robertson's in there. Robertson doing well. And the deflection, it's a goal for Hearts! Oh, what a disaster for Hibs. John Robertson playing the ball into the middle. Oh, what a record this little man has of causing trouble for Hibs. Andy Gorham looking quite disconsolate.
Craig Levine there. Poised for the cross. Levine with a header and a ball in the net, and it's John Robertson, I think, getting the final touch. Certainly a powerful header from Craig Levine, right through the Hibs defence. Robertson was lurking there. 24 minutes on the clock. Hibernian 0, Hearts 2.
Miss Anderson to Cahoon, to Mackay. Stringing the passes together. George Wright, away though by Gordon Hunter. Still Hearts keeping on the pressure. Cahoon, good ball through to Foster, he's got Robertson in the middle. John Robertson, what a goal by Hearts! Oh, that was magnificent play.
I think the only disappointing fact at the end was that we only won 3-0. We probably could have and should have went down the slope, attempt to score more goals, but Sandy Clark had prepared us superbly that day. The professionalism of the Hearts players going out and keeping their heads and keeping the ball moving, and some of the football we played on the day was quite fantastic, and that's the one for all different reasons that probably stands out the most.
Hart's prolific goal tally of that period had relied largely on Robbo, but like all strikers, he relied on the players around him, players like John Cahoon and Scott Crabb.
There was a rumour going about at the time that Subuto wanted to put a writ out on the three of us because of our size, but no, it was funny because we'd gone from a very, very successful period with John Cahoon, Sandy Clark, myself, where Sandy was a real aerial threat. We got a lot of goals from that, to got John, myself and Wayne Foster as well. Weren't the biggest, but we did with terrific movement. John Coon was a fantastic winger, one of the best wingers that Scotland have produced. And Scott Crabb and myself, we had a real understanding. We didn't seem to need to talk on the park. We knew each other's movement. We knew when each other was going to dummy the ball for the other one to spin. And we knew when to pull defenders out of position for the other one. And we had a real great relationship both on and off the park. You know, I was going to a kid of mine, he was my apprentice, and I'm his mentor, he'll probably say tormentor, but I've got a great affinity. It was like a wee brother, the relationship I had with Scott Crabb, just that one of these things that came off.
Oh, I looked up to wee Robbo, you know. Yeah, Robbo was my hero, you know, and to go into Tynecastle straight for school, go on the ground staff and to be faced with guys like that, you know, it was a dream come true for me. The understanding we had was superb, you know, and some teams just couldn't handle us on the day. The movement the gear showed, and it was just a joy to play in, you know. They say I was a young one out of three, and I was just like loving this, you know, playing up front and scoring goals with these two guys that I'd looked up to.
Play by Gary Mackay. Yeah,
sensational goal for Hearts. Scott Crabb. 1 minute gone here at Tynecastle. Andy Gorham, well, he just can't believe it. The first time shot from Scott Crabb.
Hearts again had shown great determination in the face of adversity, with the Tynecastle men finishing second in the league and reaching the semi-finals of the Scottish Cup. The following season again saw managerial changes when Joe Jordan left and was replaced by Sandy Clark. Considering the upheaval, the team performed well, finishing fifth in the league and again reaching the semi-finals of the Scottish Cup.
Waiting for Baird to make his way into the area. There's Preston!
However, off the field, the club was again facing financial difficulties. Changes had to be made. In June 1994, Chris Robinson and Leslie Deans bought Wallace Mercer's 51% share of Hearts for £2.1 million.
I suppose it was round about 92, 93 when I was beginning to see a little bit more inside the doors of Hearts through the catering contract that I had for my company. And I didn't particularly like what I saw, a club that I loved. I didn't think it was being particularly well run. And naturally, you always feel you can do better. And that's what I suppose got my interest going as a supporter, but also as a businessman, and particularly as a frustrated supporter who had seen the club come so close to success on many occasions during my adult lifetime, but never actually delivering the success that the supporters craved.
The new board looked for a new manager. Tommy McLean, who had a proven track record and had led Motherwell to the Scottish Cup, was the choice. But the partnership did not work well. And on the 4th of August 1995, former captain Jim Jeffries arrived from Falkirk. He quickly realised that changes had to be made.
It wasn't going to be easy, because the club had no money, but the players who had given their all for this club were maybe coming to the end of their time, and it was maybe time for change. You know, I came in and I gave people a chance, a couple of additions, but you know, after 8 or 9 games, the old feelings came back. We went bottom of the league, and that was time to get the thing going. And I think we took some bold steps the following that Falkirk day, and we brought in 3 foreigners, and we brought in 3 youngsters, and said, you're in not just for 1 game or 2 games, you're in now. You've been crying out for a chance. You've done your apprenticeship in the reserves. The Johnstons, the Locks, the McManus and the Ritchie were given a chance and a good run in the team, along with these 2 or 3 new players that we brought in. And everybody realised that was something going to happen.
Changes saw Neil Poynton and Steve Fulton join the club, a former international goalkeeper, Gilles Rousset, arrived, and an ex-Serie A sweeper, Pasquale Bruno. Bottom of the table in November, Hearts were now chasing for points near the top of the league. In January, they met league leaders Rangers at Ibrox.
Towards Calhoun, but John Calhoun is battling away, he's beaten Petrich. Alan Lawrence inside, Johnston making ground in the middle. Return pass, Calhoun again. It's cut back, Alan Johnston! Forward from Poynton, Johnston through the middle! He's done it again! It's Johnston's second! And out of almost nothing, Hearts have struck blow number 2. Grim faces on the Rangers bench, our team really being vastly outplayed at the moment. There's Poynton through the middle, Alan Johnston, can he score his hat-trick? What a moment for the youngster! Johnston, he's done it! A superb finish.
finish from Alan Johnston, and Hearts' victory over Rangers is surely now complete.
At just 20, Gary Locke was the youngest ever captain of Hearts, but Jim Jeffries had no doubts about making the appointment.
We looked at this lad in training and we put him in a team. He was a real prospect, a real fire in his belly. He trained the way that he played. He was a jambo through and through. They had the respect, the most important thing, had the respect of the older players, and suddenly we knew how, the examples he would set. I thought a great decision at that time, and giving Gary the captaincy, and we don't regret it one bit.
Gary's leadership qualities, along with the managerial skills of Jim Jeffries and his assistant Billy Brown, had made this season a success. That same determination and will to win paid off again in the Scottish Cup campaign.
Swinger, troublesome, Lukovic beats it away. It's McPherson being hounded by two defenders. Mackay sends it back, there's no offside. Gary Mackay flights it in. There's Berry. A deflection! 2-1 to Hearts! In behind. John Hill. To Hounslow. Here's Robertson. Hearts are a lot of players forward here. One of them's Gary Mackay. The great goal for Hearts! Scored by Lawrence. Position this to be exploited by Hearts. Coulton over the ball, far post cross. Queuing up, McPherson! Could scarcely have been simpler. We do have a second opportunity here to put some pressure on the Aberdeen defence. Poynton's corner. There's Dave McPherson's header! Cleared by Michael Watt! And it's there! John Robertson has scored! Rousey halfway towards the halfway line. Stuart McKimmie didn't get there. John Robertson will keep this in. Neil Poynton's inside. Johnston's in the middle. There is Johnston's header! Alan Johnston has scored for Hearts! This match takes another amazing twist. The cross from Robertson, and Alan Johnston was there, and the powerful downward header, and it squeezed its way under Michael Watt. There is the final whistle, and Hearts are through to the final of the Tennent Scottish Cup.
Yes, that victory took Hearts to their first Scottish Cup final in 10 years, where they would meet Rangers. Their league match, 4 days later, was seen by many as a rehearsal for the Hampden clash. Hearts went ahead when Neil Poynton hit an unstoppable shot past Andy Gorham. The match was won when Steve Fulton threaded the ball through to Alan Johnston, and he shrugged off Richard Goff's challenge to smash the ball home. The stage was set for an epic final. Hearts were confident, having already beaten Rangers twice in the league by convincing margins. But once again, the loyal Tynecastle supporters were to taste disappointment.
Jury's pass, here's Lovren. Manis goes back with him. Played an early this time, but Jury!
It was a sore one, but we said that, we'd achieved a lot that year. And the best way to get it out of your system is to get back to another final.
That goal was to be the Coca-Cola Cup. However, in the quarter-final, they had to beat Celtic, who were second in the league and equally hungry for a trophy.
Well, Celtic, when the draw was made, this was a tricky tie for them, make no mistake about it. Away in Edinburgh, all the passion of Tynecastle.
Robertson, he scored!
Got a goal here
in heroic circumstances.
After that dramatic extra-time victory, Hearts knocked out Dundee 3-1 in the semi-final. Again, they would face Rangers in a cup final. Disaster seemed to strike again as Rangers scored two goals. But even the opposition manager knew that Hearts would not submit easily.
Walters already admitted that he could see enough in that day after the 5-1 and 2-0 down. He's seen a lot of determination in Hearts, and he proved that how Hearts had something about them that, you know, this comeback that they're starting to have in the longer term was something that he knew was realistic.
Despite the 4-3 defeat, Hearts' confidence was strong as ever, as their old rivals Hibs were about to find out. For John Robertson, it was an unforgettable season. He was chasing Jimmy Wardhaw's remarkable record of 206 league goals. Fittingly for John, that record was finally beaten against Rangers on the last day of the season.
Petrie's letting in John Robertson. This is a chance. That looks like a penalty. It is! And referee Jim McCluskey had no hesitation pointing to the spot. John Robertson to break the league goal-scoring record. Robertson, shot, goal! And Tyne Castle goes wild!
Robbo's second goal provided the perfect response to those who claimed that he was purely a penalty box striker.
John Robertson again, persistence, chance to run at Jörgen Björklund. He's inside of Robertson. This is a chance for a goal, Robertson! It's a great goal by John Robertson! He's not only broke the record, he smashed it!
The second goal was adrenaline. You talk about nerves, I was so nervous with the penalty kick because... you know, I knew what it was for, everybody knew what it was for, and I still hadn't, you know, hadn't been offered a contract. That said, I didn't know if I was going to be there next year, and I thought, well, this could be the last chance you've got to break it. But fortunately, I kept calm enough to stick it away. I think just the relief of scoring that goal spurred me on for the second one. It was just a run on pure adrenaline. I don't know where I got those legs from, but it was great. It capped off the day for me, and, you know, I knew then, obviously, walking off, that if I hadn't been offered another deal, then I could rest with the fact that I'd broken the record. Fortunately, Jim Jeffries saw it fit to keep me for one more season.
In only two seasons, Jim Jeffries had taken Hearts to two cup finals and revitalised his squad. Everyone at the club could sense that something momentous was about to happen, and it came in the Scottish Cup campaign of 1998. After overcoming Albion Rovers and Ayr United, Hearts met Falkirk in the semi-final.
Well judged by Jim Hamilton. And in from Stephen Adan. 5 minutes gone. It's a dream start for Hearts. Jim Hamilton stretched to get there. Adan, good reverse pass for Neil McCann. McCann in behind Neil Bowie. And Neil McCann!
The words I said at the time was, if you keep getting to finals, that'll happen. It was just terrific that the next final we got to, if you give me all the clubs to beat, it would have been Rangers, because the fact that they'd beaten us in the two previous ones.
The great day came at Parkhead in May, where they knew that they could bury once and for all the misfortune that had plagued Hearts since their last trophy win 36 years previously.
There was just that gut feeling that this was, you know, the third time, lucky they say. It was going to be our day. We were going to give it our best shot. We were well prepared. We knew the punters who were on the TV and the journalists in the press would all say that Rangers did this, Rangers and that. It wasn't going to matter to us. So we had to go there with a real game plan that wasn't going to help to impress anybody, and because the supporters were only interested in winning the cup.
Steve Poulter. And he's made a distinctive break, and it's a penalty! Would you believe it? 30 seconds gone. Fulton's weaving run brought the challenge, which Willie Young thought was an offence, and he's pointed to the penalty spot. And what a dramatic start here. And now, more than ever, Rangers will be relying on the experience of Andy Gorham, who's never been beaten in his previous Scottish Cup appearances. But he's been beaten for the first goal of the game, and it's Cameron who's given Hearts a real edge with a penalty in the second minute. Stolen, and it's 2-0, and Amoruso for a moment went to sleep, and Stephen Adam took full advantage, and Hearts now send their supporters into raptures with a real opportunity of winning their first silverware in 36 years. Here's Gattuso, McCoist, goal!
Goal by McCoist.
McCoy scored, and we were under intense pressure. But I've never seen a team so determined to not lose a match, given the circumstances and everything. So it was terrific.
In the final minutes, the pressure on Hearts was intense, but this time there would be no last-minute goal for the opposition, and the Gorgie men stood firm to win a glorious victory.
And the long, long wait is over, and Hearts have won the Scottish Cup. It's their first silverware for 36 years, season now has a prize to go with it.
The moment had finally arrived when Hearts captain Stevie Fulton, along with the injured Gary Locke, could finally carry a trophy back to those ecstatic fans in Edinburgh. Over 200,000 supporters packed the streets of the capital to celebrate the historic cup win. It was an emotional day for fans and players alike.
The nearer we get to Tynecastle, the more people were hanging out windows, and terrific. And then just to finish off, to come into a full stadium to see so many people just crying with joy, if that doesn't make you more determined to bring another trophy to the club, then nothing wrong. But nothing will ever surpass that, because I think the fact that all these heartaches in the 1986 and people probably thinking that Hearts were never ever going to win anything in their time, that was a joy.
But no history of Hearts could ever be complete without reference to the great derby games with Hibs. Between 1989 and 1994, Hearts were unbeaten in 22 matches against their oldest rivals.
Now Foster, pulling it back for Bannon. Robertson. Yes! Now Cahoney's in behind Milne, releasing the ball early. And it's played in by Tosh McKinley. Cahoney leaves it to Crabb. Chance for McPherson on the turn. Hearts are two ahead. Gorham coming out to challenge with a header. There's Gary Mackay. And Hearts have scored a third. Good play by McPherson. There's Houchin back defending. And a great goal by Levine. Supported by Cahoon. And Cahoon now hustled by two players. He still gets the cross in.
Here comes McKinley. Fine play by McKinley. And the opening goal for Hearts is scored by John Robertson. 2.5 minutes on the clock. And the hammer of Hibs does it again. Here's Foster, using his pace, a chance to win the game for Hearts. He's done it! It's Wayne Foster's first goal of the season, and it surely won the tie for Hearts.
But like every other club, Hearts cannot dwell on the past. Ambitious plans have already been laid for the future. Chris Robinson is planning a multi-million pound youth academy for Hearts.
We're in the process of finalising a deal for a site to the west of Edinburgh. That will be a really tremendous opportunity for the club to further develop our excellent youth system. We'll have somewhere in the region of 6 pitches, an indoor training hall 60 metres by 40, state-of-the-art facilities. There'll be even a place where the youngsters who are in for their evening coaching can do their homework. And it will be the venue where the first team are based and train, and all of our football activities will be centred around this. And it will be amongst the best in the UK. We're really very excited. And it's as big a project as rebuilding the stadium in terms of building for the future.
For 125 eventful years, Heart of Midlothian's place in the history of Scottish football has been assured. For everyone associated with this famous old club, there exists an emotional bond which will never be broken.
We had a great time because of the supporters. And it's supporters you worry about. I mean, there are a lot of them don't worry about Ken and supporters, but they were part and parcel of our victories.
My ambition, or my whole life, dreams, I would say, what do you want to do? I say, play for Hearts and be captain of Hearts. Play for Scotland, be captain of Scotland. That'll do me. I don't want any more.
If you can bring other trophies to the club and keep the club progressing, then you might eventually finish up starting your career at Hearts and finishing your career at Hearts. And it'd be fantastic if that would be a terrific thing to do. But as I say, football is a changing game. You can never tell. But it would certainly be an ambition of mine to do that.
What did it mean? Oh, everything. I mean, it's every boy's dream to play for the team that you've supported, you know. And I mean, I had that chance when I went straight for school, 15. I mean, as soon as that bell went at school, it was my last day. I was out of there, and right into Tynecastle. It was like, couldn't get in quick enough, and to go on and play in the first team. The guys that you've looked up to, I certainly feel one of the luckiest guys in the world to have done it. You know, I'm absolutely delighted. Nobody can take it away from me that I've played for them.
The only disappointing thing for me was on the Friday night I went to collect my boots. I actually walked into an empty stadium, and I'm no different than a lot of players that have had to do that. But it was quite eerie walking into a stadium that was totally empty and picking up my boots. The only other time I'd probably done that was the day that I went to pick up my boots before I played for Scotland. And the next time you do it was to leave the club 10 or 12 years later. It was gut-wrenching.
People say that Hearts have got a lot to thank me for. I think it's our way about. I've got a lot to thank Hearts for, because they were a club that gave me a platform for 18 years to play football. I had a tremendous relationship with players there. I had a fantastic relationship with the fans. And Hearts are my team, it's as simple as that. You know, that's a team that I'll always be identified with, and I wouldn't want it any other way. And I just hope now that they go from strength to strength and continue to challenge for titles, win titles and win cups, because the club and the fans certainly deserve it.
Some say the Celtic and rain.
is a strong